Good afternoon and welcome to Midday Live from the News Hub at Adesawe Kanda. I am Wendy Lai. Coming up this afternoon, Togolese nationals in Ghana protest the 50-year rule of the Nyasibis. Meanwhile, opposition coalition in Togo stages demonstration demanding the restoration of the country's 1992 constitution. From that's free SHS to commence next week, but how prepared are the schools? We will be finding out. And 4 out of every 10 Ghanaian cannot read in any language. As we mark World Literacy Day, we will explore the challenges. Government says it will inaugurate the boards of polytechnics and universities on Friday. And on the firing front, UN Security Council sets up a sanction system allowing the UN to penalize anyone who violates Mali's 2015 peace deal.
The details of these stories and many more lined up. Do stay.
We start with our stories and let's head straight to Togo, where some Togolese nationals residing here in Ghana Wednesday morning protested against the 50-year rule of the Nyasibis. Natalie Fort comes through with the following report.
Here at Kawukudi in Accra, many Togolese residing in Ghana are protesting against the 50-year rule of Foro Nasingbe. They're also calling for a return of the 1992 constitution, which allows for multi-party democracy. They say that the development of Togo has been stifled by the 50-year rule of the Nasingbes.
Four must go!
No, we don't have freedom of speech. We don't have even the human rights application to rule the country. We are frustrated. We are very tired. As you can see, most of the Togolese are now in Ghana, Benin, and all over the world. So that is what we feel. As we are living in Ghana, we see what is going on here. We see how people are moving, how people are doing their own life, how people are selling, how people are buying, how people are behaving within the society. So this kind of treatment we don't have in Togo. So you can bear with me that it's really affecting the country, the entire life of people living in the country.
Our purpose is our president for Nyasingbe. We want to tell him to step down for 50 years rule. He is my father.
So we're still focusing on Togo, and this afternoon I do have in the studio Ridwan Saidu, who is the advisor to the Togolese Association here in Ghana. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
And thanks for your time.
Thank you too.
Now, your president amended the constitution. Why won't you wait for his term to end?
Thank you very much, and thank you, and greeting to your panelists, your viewers rather. True. As you're talking about the constitution, the amendments of the constitution was not properly done because the 1992 constitution was written by people. Because if I say it was written by people, the reason is it was by way of, people wrote it, understand? By way of referendum. And it means that that constitution is for people of Togo. But the amendment was not done in consultation with Togolese. It was done by the former president who, after his demise, his child is also taking over from him. So it wasn't done by Togolese, and the protests went against it since it was amended.
Now, the opposition is divided, and would you advise that they come together to achieve this cause you're looking at?
Yeah, for now, they were divided, but they are together now, as I'm telling you. People protesting today is a coalition of opposition.
You're confident that opposition. All of them are in this?
Yes, no, they sat on meetings, upon meetings, and now they came into conclusion that they all have to be one and fight for the same cause. So it's a coalition that is now demonstrating not one party. The one on the 19th was done by one party, but today it's by all the opposition leaders.
Now, how confident are you that what you've done today in the series of demonstrations, even in Togo, will yield results before we go to what you've picked up in Togo?
Yes. By the support of world organizations, as we talk, this demonstration is to call on the UN, the ECOWAS, and all other organizations like the EU to also, you know, put some pressures on them for them to accept their people, because you rule people and not to go against them. Mm. Togolese people should not become the enemy of the government, because Togolese don't feel that the government's their enemy. So they should rather come together and come to conclusion and make sure that they should all respect the constitution that was written by the people.
Okay. Now let me just hold you there and go on the phone line and speak to Emmanuel Kutin. He's the Chief Executive Officer of the Africa Center for Security and Counterterrorism. Good afternoon and thanks for agreeing to speak with us.
Good afternoon.
Now, what do you make of the current development in Togo, and does this pose a threat to peace?
Well, thank you and good afternoon to your very curious viewers. In fact, the happiness in Togo is not a good thing we as a country should even be happy about, because any act of destabilization in Togo will actually have a negative effect on Ghana. Mm. And you remember when this issue came up, I was one of those who criticized the ECOWAS, the African Union, and the United Nations office in West Africa and the Sahel. But you see, unknown to us, they had on the quiet embarked on what we call soft diplomacy and made the Togolese government to reason that in this age and time, a democratic dispensation are the people's rights. And if you listen to a happening that is coming out from Togo yesterday, there have actually been a preliminary draft of the law that modifies the Article 62, the 49, and the 60. That has been the bone of contention, and that deals with the term limit. Hmm. And the government have now agreed to set a project in place where all the political parties will come to a round table and agree on certain things. So I think that the opposition party in Togo should for at least take the government by its words and go to the round table and get this thing done. And if I may even quote from the official communique, it states that the initiative is to create a climate of peace and serenity that is indispensable in allowing Togo to intensify its efforts that aim to respect important concerns of Togolese. And additionally, it is to help improve their living conditions.
But do you believe in that initiative? Do you think that it's possible in the first place?
It is very possible. Like I mentioned, I think we have to respect procedure. Because ECOWAS, the African Union, and the UN office in West Africa and the Sahel got these processes in place. So if these processes are ongoing, I think the opposition party needs to exhaust these processes before or otherwise going on the demonstration they are doing now. Because anybody will say that if the government is giving out or making these demands, why is the opposition demonstrating? That is in bad faith. Okay. And we have to call a spade a spade.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Emmanuel Kutin is the Chief Executive Officer of the Africa Center for Security and Counterterrorism. Now, Ridwan, before I let you go, you heard the gentleman speak. That's the Chief Executive Officer of the Africa Center for Security and Counterterrorism. And then he talked about the initiative which is being put in place by government, bringing on the opposition on board. Finally, what do you think it's possible? He believes that procedure should be followed. What do you make of this?
You see, the situation in Togo, if you are not within Togo, your conscience may make you like as if people there are not telling the truth. Many of these have been done before, and that it has not yielded any results. So the opposition will not allow this thing anymore. The United Nations and all over all those people we are talking about have never come to be to do the arbitrage to make sure these people come together and follow one. Always they promise something, they never fulfill it. You see? So why should the government wait until today before coming up with a proposal?
All right. What next then?
Then, as he just spoke, we also call in the UN, the ECOWAS, and all other organizations to take this as a concern.
All right.
And shouldn't sit down as if Togo is not an island. Mm. So they should all come together and make sure we have peace there so that it doesn't escalate
all right.
to other things.
Thank you so much, Ridwan Said, who is the advisor to the Togolese Association here in Ghana. But away from Togo, Deputy Minister of Education in charge of secondary schools, technical and vocational training, says the ministry is yet to release monies to the schools for the free senior high school policy. He, however, adds that textbooks have already been distributed to the schools.
The deputy minister said funds for the free SHS would be ready before schools reopen.
We are working on it. Everything that is due charge will get to charge. Feeding, we are working with the buffer stock. This is an agency of the Ministry of Agri, agency of government. They are facilitating all the food distribution and everything. We had a long meeting with them today. We are following up. Everything will be streamlined. We want to make sure that schools open and that students will be served and that everybody will be happy.
He, however, says textbooks have already been distributed.
This is the first time in the history of the country where we are distributing textbooks before school opens. And you know, the interesting thing is this. We are not just distributing textbooks for the first year. We are distributing textbooks for the entire 3 years. So books that are going to schools, now if it's mathematics, it's math one, math two, math three. It's never happened in the history of this country. And we are doing another one schools to improve, and that's exactly what the Ministry of Education is doing. Supplementary books will be going. The core textbooks are being distributed. Never happened before that we distribute books before students get to school.
On the challenges with the computerized placement for prospective senior high students, the minister said they are monitoring the system and would ensure the 92% students who qualified for the senior high are placed by Thursday.
When is the new deadline?
Thursday. Yeah, we are watching. I won't call it deadline, but it's a guidepost for us to really guide ourselves and see. Because the whole idea, the reason why I wanted to do it as early as possible is to make sure that students go to school early. Over the years, students were losing the first term. So you lose the first term, and then why begin the exams when you're in the third year from February? You lose 1.5 terms. So what was supposed to be 3 years of senior secondary school became 2 years. That is why we're saying, hey, can you do 48 hours? But technology doesn't respond to our needs all the time.
Meanwhile, the website has been changed from the www.myjhsresults.net to www.csspsgov.gh.
And a pre-senior high school classes organized for junior high graduates within the Koro constituency has been hijacked by participants from the Lejokuku, Tema West and Asherman. The one-month core subjects and counseling classes by the Member of Parliament for Koro, Elizabeth Afolikwe, attracted a record of 795, nearly 300 more than the expected target.
The much-touted Free Senior High School mantra of the Akufo-Addo government is set to begin in 2 weeks when fresh students are admitted into the various second cycle schools. But even before that happens, some individuals have offers and orientation for the teaming students. For the Member of Parliament for Krowa Constituency, Elizabeth Afole Kwe, an orientation is key in preparing the students in the constituency for the task ahead. The event attracted a record 850 participants, including 4 persons with disability, and involved 24 teachers in 7 classes. However, the biggest revelation was that a large proportion of participants came from Ashaman, Tema West, and Lejokuku constituencies. They were taking through 4 core subjects: English, Maths, Science, and Social Studies, in addition to counseling. It was held between July 31 and August 31 at the Kwe Nungwa RC Primary and Junior High School, at the end of which Abraham Adom won in both academic and moral assessments.
Before this program, I have thought of getting a teacher who will teach me for pre-SHS lessons, but I heard about Honorable Afole Elizabeth, and I decided to go to these classes.
But why organize classes for people who are already going to benefit from free education?
We realize that as youth, as adolescents, they might want to engage themselves in certain or some deviant behaviors. But when we keep them, you know, in school, under guidance and counseling, they'll be able to achieve something positive, so they can take with them all the way into the SHS and also throughout their lives.
Various speakers at the closing ceremony urged participants to eschew indiscipline and immorality in order to justify government spending on education.
All right, so my colleague Evelyn Tingma is gauging the preparedness of senior high schools ahead of reopening, which is next week. But we're trying to get Evelyn shortly. If you have a ward, you know someone who's going to senior high school, remember you can send your comments on our social media platforms. Facebook and Twitter is News on TV3. Tell us what you've gathered so far, what the challenges are, and what your expectations are. So Evelyn Tingma is gauging the preparedness of senior high schools ahead of reopening. And my colleague Nanekia Mensah-Brampa is also at the Central Business District, where she will be interacting with traders ahead of sales and what they make of a patronage of chop boxes as school reopens. So Evelyn Tingma is ready for us now.
Of course, when they report to school, the free senior high policy will also be implemented. And so we are here in the Accra Girls Senior High School to find out what exactly parents or guardians and school authorities have put in place in terms of this free senior high policy. And so here at the Accra Girls Senior High School, unfortunately, we have not been able to get any information because we are told that the headmistress is attending a CHARS meeting. Of course, all the heads of institutions are attending the CHARS meeting in Kumasi. And so we've not been able to get any information. But as we speak, we have been seeing some parents and their wards walking into the reception of the school. But we'll be finding out, and a couple of them have been finding out what exactly they're supposed to do. And you know that they are supposed to bring their printed information to the school for the awards to be placed. But we know about the SHS policy, the free senior high policy, and students are expected to have tuition free, feeding free, and even PTA levy, everything free. And so that is why we are here, to find out from the heads of institutions whether they have received all the information, all the materials, and all the funds for the policy to be implemented. And unfortunately, we've not been able to get that information here. And we will also go to other schools and check out what information they have, because already we are told that the schools have received all the free textbooks that government promised. And so we want to find out if indeed this information is really true, and we'll also find out exactly what other materials and what other funds that the schools have received, because we are told by the deputy minister that they have not received the monies yet. And of course, Charles some days back said that the monies are yet to hit their accounts. And so we will try and get all these information and then bring our viewers up to speed. But from the Accra High, as Accra Senior Girls Senior High School here in Accra, we've not had any information. And so we will try and go to other schools and try to see if we can get any other information and bring our viewers up to speed on this free SHS development.
Thank you very much, Evelyn, for that update. And we look at one of our headline stories now. Lack of logistics, teaching and learning materials are hampering effective supervision and facilitation of non-formal education in the South municipalities. Trainees say the situation is having a toll on their studies.
Okay, smoke.
Please, sir, smoke. Smoke.
Smoke. S-M-O. Smoke.
Give a wonderful literacy class.
Ghana has a national average literacy rate of 58%, indicating more than 4 out of every 10 Ghanaians cannot read in any language. Part of the situation has been blamed on lack of access to schools for many children, especially those within rural communities. The country has also recorded huge numbers of adult illiteracy in the recent past. According to the World Data Atlas, between 2000 and 2015, adult illiteracy in Ghana declined from 4.62 million to 3.93 million in 2015. The non-formal education division of the Ministry of Education is in charge of adult literacy programs.
Monitoring and supervision have become so difficult because all the motorbikes have broken down, all our cars have broken down. They don't have the cars to go. And if you have to go to, say, Obuom, or you have to go to, Abamule and the rest, it becomes difficult for the supervisors. So we are hoping that we'll get such logistics.
Few adults have, however, taken advantage of the program to shape their lives. 58-year-old Vincent Agbeko and a father of 7 ended his formal education at primary 2 due to financial difficulties. Vincent told the news team constant humiliation meted out by society as a result of his illiteracy compelled him to enroll in non-formal education. After a year, this is what he can do.
Papu Wanasi told the chief that he could sing better when his hand had his right hand is in his pocket.
As part of activities to mark this year's International Literacy Day, the Ministry of Education, in partnership with the Jinyami Lions Club, has held a Deba in the Gan South municipality to whip up adults' interest in non-formal education.
I was amazed particularly by the fact that grandmothers and grandfathers could spell and read and even do some calculations the way they did. We want to bring literacy to the doorstep of as many people as possible, young and old.
The adult trainees were engaged in learning activities such as dictation, reading and problem solving.
Blind.
They are
blind. Blind. Candidate one, can you spell blind? Blind. Mone nani. Blind.
The International Illiteracy Day is slated for Friday, September 8, 2017, under the theme, A Digital World in Ghana, the Case of Functional Literacy.
You're still watching Midday Live, and information we're gathering is that government will inaugurate the boards of the polytechnic and universities on Friday, and shortly we will be going on the phone line to speak to Otopla. He is the PRO for the Ministry of Education until we do have him via phone. Good afternoon, sir, and thanks for your time.
Good afternoon.
Now, can you confirm? All right. Now, can you confirm if indeed government will inaugurate the boards for technical universities this Friday?
Thank you. I can positively confirm that the boards of 6 out of the 8 technical universities will be inaugurated on Friday.
And have you communicated this to the relevant stakeholders, which includes the Technical Universities Association?
Yes, letters have been sent to them. You know, for some time now, there have been agitation at their front because the boards and councils have not been inaugurated. We give them the assurance that as soon as the list is released, we will be able to do it. Thankfully, the list has come, and then we'll be doing that on Friday. I also take the opportunity to thank the association for having faith in the ministry and then abating the agitations they have had for some time now.
Well, I asked Friday. If I can just hold you there, I asked that question because I do have the General Secretary for Technical Universities Teachers Association here with me. That's David Worry Brown. And when you answered that question about informing the association, he said no. I've also asked him before we even started this interview, and he's indicated that that is not the case.
Yes, letters have been sent today. I cannot confirm exactly whether he has received it.
So the letters were sent today?
Yes, the letters have been sent.
Well, thank you so much. I have been speaking to Otoplai. He is the PRO for the Ministry of Education. What do you make of what he just said?
Thank you. I think that until we receive the letters and until the councils are inaugurated, we will just see this as one of the assurances that government has been given. Because we believe that as stakeholders, and more so when we've been calling for these councils, if such is the information, they could have actually called to even inform us, to hint us this is what is happening. What we saw yesterday was where the students who had completed school went on some demonstration, and the deputy minister, I read this in the news, that he came out to say that the councils are going to be inaugurated. And we also heard this in the media. But we believe that that is not the appropriate way of communicating to us, because we have been engaging you. So if you have these good tidings, why won't you communicate that to us? And until he's saying that letters have been sent today. So until we see the letter saying that inviting our various representatives for the inauguration, we would take this with a pinch of salt. That's what we're going to say. And last, we met the Labour Commission last week, Wednesday. The ministry never showed up, the minister never showed up, nobody from the ministry came up. So we actually wanted to declare our strike, but Labour Commission pleaded with us to hold on and call for a meeting today. And so today at 3 p.m. we are going to the Labour Commission, and if we do not meet anyone, the minister does not represent himself or someone else, we are going to take our appropriate action, because we've waited for
which
all
is?
This one. Yeah, so we'll declare that the strike. And we think that government should take education in this country seriously. You know what is happening in Winneba, across the country, and we think that these things should not be allowed to continue. We believe that government should not wait for there to be agitation before we respond to the needs of education. No, it shouldn't be the case. This has been, we don't understand. Why must we always agitate? Why must we always be hitting on government before government responds? We don't understand.
So if I got you right, informally, you've heard government speak about the inauguration of the board.
Yes.
Through the media.
Yes, I just heard the PRO saying it even here, because I saw the news, some kind of posting on the Ghana web, the PD Minister for Tertiary Education addressing a kind of press conference, saying that the councils are going to be inaugurated on a Friday. So we have not been written to, we have not even been called and be told that, no. But when we agitated, we were going on strike, we were written to by the minister, he signed himself, and said that, everything is with the Council of State for recommendations.
Okay.
So if it has moved from there, and inauguration will be taking place on Friday, you could have actually informed us. Maybe perhaps if you had, and when you called me, I would have told you that we have had this written information, and you could have. But for us, we're meeting Labour Commission. If by the close of today we don't see them there and we will not receive any communication, it means that it's just one of those assurances that they've always been giving us.
All right. Well, finally, your book and research allowance.
The book and research, after a tough fight, some institutions have been paid. We have one of our own, which has not been paid, as a Cape Coast Technical University. They have not been paid. We heard that there were a few delays, some mistakes, and we are using this platform to ask whoever is responsible, wherever it has reached. We've been following up. It has moved from Ministry of Finance to expedite action on that to make sure that they receive their book and research allowances.
All right. Well, thank you so much. I have been speaking to the General Secretary, Technical University Teachers Association, and that's David Worry Brown. We're looking at the inauguration of the board of these universities. You're still watching Midday Live. And Ghana's anti-Galamsey tax force has, within the last month, arrested 294 illegal small-scale miners operating in three regions of the country. Now, the illegal miners were arrested in the Eastern, Ashanti, and Western regions. And the latest arrest on Monday was made up of 22 foreigners, 19 Chinese, one Burkinabe, and one Nigerian.
This was revealed on Tuesday when the Interministerial Task Force led by the Defence Minister Dominic Nitiwul and the Interior Minister Ambus Dewi paid a working visit to the task force at Takwa in the Western Region, Osino in the Eastern Region and Obuasi in the Ashanti Region. The Military Camp Police Task Force, codenamed Operation Vanguard, was deployed on July 31 to three regions to prevent the upsurge of illegal mining in the country. The visit created a platform for the task force to voice out its challenges to the government. Members of the task force were unhappy about the false reportage on their activities in the media.
We are having to conduct operations on water bodies, and safety has been our key concern during these operations. We are concerned so much because as we operate on and along these bodies, troops may, those who are not used to the water bodies, may drown or things of that nature. Some of the areas too are not accessible. We are therefore looking forward to the coming on board fully of the Marine Police and the Ghana Navy. And we understand that the wheel of justice grinds slowly. However, we still think that a word probably to the authorities who are concerned with prosecution to fast-track these cases may help the cause of this task force.
Equipment, including 23 excavators, two floating machines, 108 water pumps, 11 vehicles, 11 generator sets, and 13 motorbikes, have been seized by the task force. Also, 563 floating machines named Chamfan have been destroyed, as well as six excavators. Meanwhile, over 66 excavators have been voluntarily moved to the urban centers following the presence of the task force in the three regions. The Defense Minister Dominic Nitiwul said government is determined to provide all the necessary support for the desired result to be achieved.
If anybody thinks that we are just doing 3 days, 2 days, like what used to happen before, that person should think twice. We are staying for a very long time. Even when the troops on the ground, the people with the boots on the ground, even when they have exhausted their work, we are going to leave the Marine Police and the Navy for a long time to patrol our waters. Apart from that, we are going to get the soldiers to remain here and make sure that the reclamation exercise takes place and takes place fully. We will not allow anybody to degrade the forest any longer.
The task force was excited with the support given them so far by residents of the various towns. The ministers promised government support to fight against illegal mining.
No doubt play a vital role in modern life, but its effect on the environment cannot be ignored. In the following report, Portia Gabo looks at the effect of plastic waste on marine life and the environment.
Tons of plastic waste end up on the shorelines of Ghana's beaches daily. According to the United Nations Environment Programme, more than 8 million tons of plastic end up in the oceans each year, wreaking havoc on marine wildlife, fisheries and tourism.
Plastic waste menace in this country would simply not go away. Here at Teshi Sanguena, it looks as if this place is the final resting place of most plastics that we consume. Instead of tourists coming here to enjoy the scenery, they are confronted and greeted with this.
Estimates by the UN suggest oceans will carry more plastic than fish by 2050, and an estimated 99% of seabirds would have ingested plastic. The fishermen here at Teshi Sangwena are worried.
When we go fishing, we catch more plastic waste than fish. We need waste collectors here. When it rains, some residents dump their refuse into the ocean, but the refuse rolls back onto the shoreline.
Figures from the United Nations Environment Programme show 79% of the world's plastic waste is accumulating in landfills or slurring off in the natural environment as litter. If present trends continue, there will be 12 billion metric tons of plastic in landfills by 2050. Statistics from the Accra Metropolitan Assembly indicate that out of the over 2,500 tons of waste generated daily, only 1,125 tons, representing 45%, is collected. The remaining 55%, mainly plastics, remain mostly at landfill sites without recourse to recycling. Unfortunately, plastics here may take thousands of years to decompose.
It is actually a menace because though in volume or the weight is not much, but because of it is very light, it spreads easily and then it finds its way on our beachfront and causing a whole lot of mess.
At that known landfill site, some waste collectors capitalize on the availability of plastic waste to earn a living.
After sorting the plastic from the waste, we have those who came close to us and they buy it from us.
How much money do you make?
At least 30 cedis a day.
Kenya joined countries such as Rwanda, China and France in banning plastic bags. Would a ban be the solution to the plastic waste menace in Ghana?
That's what I can't believe, because benefit from it. Because most of us do not get any job. So these things help us a lot to cater for our families.
What we need to do is rather to find the right technology to take care of the processing of this plastic waste.
For waste collectors here, a ban would deprive them of their livelihood, but will these outweigh the dangers and risk posed to the environment? Poshu Gabo, TV3.
This is Midday Live. We have more.
The business segment.
Thanks for staying. Let's do business now. And Finance Minister Kenneth Oriata says the credit committee of ADB is the right institution to address the concerns of minority on approval of a 10 million cedi loan from the Agriculture Development Bank to Magdan Shipping Company.
Well, that would be the purview of the credit committee of the bank. And so I think that's where the question should be forwarded to. I mean, I think banking transactions, the credit committee goes through and then makes their recommendation.
And the Minister for Agriculture, Dr. Owusu-Ifeoyi Akutu, says the baseline audit of the cocoa sector is underway to ascertain the discrepancies in the Cocoa Roads project. According to the minister, even though 6 million cedis was budgeted for the projects by the previous government, contracts valued at 5 billion were awarded.
Do in the name of the Almighty God,
swear that I will at all times.
Swear that I will at all times
Inaugurating the board on the Cocoa Marketing Company, a subsidiary of Cocoa Board, the Minister for Agriculture, Dr. Wusefui Akoto, indicated the board is starting its work at a time when the cocoa sector is challenged with price volatility and financial malfeasance in the Cocoa Rose project.
A year ago, the world price of cocoa was around $3,000 per metric ton on the London Exchange. As we speak to you now, it's not even 1,900. That is a substantial drop of near more than one third on the price. When it's up, you make the maximum out of it by taking advantage to make the right investment, not only in production capacity, but in your infrastructure and so on. That did not happen.
Ghana lost $1 billion, while Ivory Coast lost $1.5 billion due to tumbling cocoa prices on the commodities market. Dr. Wusefui Akoto urged the 7-member board to work hard to motivate and improve conditions of cocoa farmers. He assured there is an ongoing audit into the cocoa sector value chain.
Desk audits. Now we are doing engineering audits. In other words, engineers will go to those roads that are supposed to have been constructed and check the width and this, you know, all the technical details to compare to the invoices that have been provided. So we are in the middle of it. People are out in the field. Cocoa Rose, they had a budget, the last budget of the previous administration, of something like 1.6 billion Ghana cedis. At the end of it, when we took over, we realized that they signed contracts worth nearly 5 billion.
The board chairman of the Cocoa Marketing Company, Joseph Kobenesibu, pledged they will work hard to help in the transformation agenda of the government.
The much needed financial resources to revamp the economy and create jobs and drive the transformation agenda of the government. So perform our responsibilities with all the innovation, professionalism, integrity, transparency and accountability.
Cocoa Marketing Company is the world's largest single seller and exporter of premium cocoa. CMC is mandated to promote, sell and deliver Ghana's cocoa to both local cocoa processors and international traders and processors. Cocoa Marketing Company also supports the financing of Ghana's cocoa sector by facilitating the annual syndicated loan arrangements and ensuring that sale proceeds are collected towards the repayment of the loan.
That's all for business. Next, we have sports.
Right, so it's time now to do sports here on Midday Life. My name is Yao Ofosulabi. Now, Thomas Partey showed just why he is an integral part of the Black Stars after he produced a masterpiece yesterday at the Kintele Stadium in Congo to wallop the Red Devils. Ghana played their best football in the 2018 World Cup qualifiers yet with a 5-1 win over Congo in Brazzaville, but the result may be too late to rescue Ghana's World Cup bid.
You know, before the game, and that is what everybody saw. You know, they were playing the game like there was something at stake, which there was something at stake as well, you know. So the boys delivered, you know. I'm very, very happy to be part of this. I think this time we were tactically disciplined, you know. We were very, very composed on the field, you know. We were very disciplined. Everybody was moving the way you should move, you know. Not like the first game, you know. The first game, fine, we made mistakes that we couldn't convert. Our chances, and then I think all what people saw today was like we converted all our chances. Tactically, we were very, very good. You know, defensively, we were very, very good. Everything was working good for us. You know, so I think we deserve this victory.
Also, you heard captain of the side there, Asamoah Gyan, and speaking about the team's efforts, an exceptional team effort that helped them to win in Congo. But let's go back to our earlier story where Thomas Partey produced a masterpiece at the Kintele Stadium to give the Black Stars a 5-1 win over Congo.
First win of the 2018 qualifiers for Ghana, a Richmond Boachiyadon brace and a Thomas Partey hat-trick. But no one in the team is having a party. The result at the Kintele Stadium leaves them in third place in Group E behind Uganda and Egypt, who meet in Alexandria. But it was a perfect response to Friday's poor showing against the same side on home soil in Kumasi. It was not just the first win of the qualifying campaign for Ghana. They also scored five times in one game when they had managed only one goal in the previous three games combined. All that would surely add up to the sense of frustration for Ghana fans, who would argue their team has turned up for the qualifier a bit too late. Ghana coach Kwasi Appiah's hands was forced into major changes, with captain Asamoah Gyan and his deputy absent through injury and Jordan Ayew missing through illness. Those changes seemed to bring the best out of the Black Stars, with Jan's replacement Richmond Bwachiyadom beginning and ending the riots in between Thomas Partey's hat-trick. The two may take a lot of the glory, but this was a complete team effort. Thomas Ejapong and Christian Achu burned Congo with their pace, and Efriakwa provided an efficient distracting force in midfield. Goalkeeper Richard Ofori also pulled off stunning saves. And above all, Kwasi Appiah left with his battered reputation repaired. Now there will be many Ghanaians hoping he builds on yet another five-star show in charge of the Black Stars. That's a comprehensive victory
that will... Well, so it's been a good week of football on the African continent, and Nigeria will have to wait another month before securing the place in Russia. But they were the team to beat, the best place team to beat on the African continent. And also Egypt back in control of Group E after they made up for their previous slip up in Uganda by picking up 3 points against the same opponents in Alexandria. And note, we end the sports news here on Midday Live. My name is Yao Fosulabi, and Wendy will take over with entertainment news.
Actress Ukeria Anunobi, on Tuesday, September 5, laid her son Raymond to rest. Now, Raymond, 15, passed away on Tuesday, August 22, after suffering from complications associated with sickle cell anemia. Ukeria's colleague artists were there, including Mona Lisa, Eniedo, Rita, Dominic, and other celebrities. May his soul rest in peace. Away from that story, Ghanaian actress Juliet Ibrahim has donated 1 million naira, that's equivalent to 2,766 US dollars, to flood victims in Makurdi, in the Borno state in Nigeria. Now, the award-winning actress has also started a campaign to further raise 10 million naira for the displaced flood victims. Next, we have international news. And we go for a story. And magistrates in the Kenyan capital, Nairobi, has ruled a Kenyan schoolgirl will be held in custody for 7 days in connection with a school fire in which 9 people died. The prosecution had asked for 10 days for the police to finish investigations. No charges have been mentioned yet. The Kenyan Red Cross said on its Twitter feed there had been 3 other school fires reported in different parts of the country on Monday. We bring you some more international news.
The UN Security Council has set up a sanction system allowing the UN to penalize anyone who violates Mali's 2015 peace deal, obstructs the delivery of aid, commits human rights abuses, or recruits child soldiers. According to the resolution, which was initiated by France and unanimously adopted by the 15-member Security Council, anyone who violates the terms will face a travel ban or asset freeze. A panel of experts has also been established to examine alleged violations. The European Court of Justice has rejected a challenge by Eastern European countries to a migrant relocation deal drawn up at the peak of the crisis in 2015. The EU's top court overruled Hungary and Slovakia's objections to the compulsory fixed quota scheme. Hungary has not accepted a single asylum seeker since the measures were introduced 2 years ago. They were an attempt to ease the pressure on frontline countries such as Greece and Italy. Just under 28,000 people have been relocated under the scheme rather than the 160,000 asylum seekers envisaged when it was agreed in September 2015.
And on that note, we end Midday Live. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Wendy Lai. Enjoy the rest of our programs. Good afternoon.